We are thinking around the idea of at least free to fall, you know, if you can be kind of similar to the thing where, possibly they want to achieve some of the things in the state of the state. If we were to do that, and just imagine if we did an earlier service, let's say we did a service starting at 9, and then a service at 10:30. Then we did a 9 o'clock service maybe a very abbreviated worship, meaning that you probably only do a couple songs, generally to do no nursery and no kids for that kind of offering. If we did something like that, I'm just curious by 12 years, and you're not committed to these things, I'm wondering how many of you would say, I'd be interested in attending the 9 o'clock service where there was no nursery, no kids, and you probably didn't want to be present for a while. I just wanted to just feel for who might help them. We did kind of a soft sign-up a month or so ago if you have anyone who's interested, so we can get some numbers together. We have that information. If you are interested in attending our marriage retreat this year, which is going to be February 21, 22, 23, that's going to be Friday, Saturday. We'll wrap up probably with you on Sunday. It is going to be warm. The cost of the retreat is going to be $300 per couple. And the first payment of $100 will be due by September 30th. That's why I'm waiting to get on the other side and put down that first payment of $100. It's going to be that table in the back for that information. Look to the balloons. And there's guys that have a great retreat plan here. They're going to keep her. We're going to be having a new study. We're going to be starting with some new questions. Things are out there on the table. Maybe I will have hearing questions Tuesday night as well. Those are out there on the table. The phones are working their way through rolling. The radios are working their way through the front door now. So if you get that information out there, then the youth will also be leaving. All of that happens at 6:30 this Wednesday night right here at the church. Now, last but not least, I want to let everybody know we are going to be doing a water baptism service on Sunday morning, September 1st. It will be Labor Day weekend, I believe. We would love to include anyone that is a born again believer that's never been baptized in water. Please come see me. We'd love to have you at that one area already. We're going to be baptized. We'd love to have anybody else that gets you that in that way. You aren't going to listen to the talk of Jared. Hey! Jared, listen to me. This is talking to me. Hey, stay with me if you will. I'm going to be in trouble right now. We're never going to have to. So we better have that in the prayer. Well, praise God for the great, beautiful moment that day. It's really important that we get to join our hearts and our voices together and praise Jesus. Let's pray right now that you move on every heart here that's loving and heartily loving. Let's pray that you want to talk to our worship team that they bring us to this opportunity, that they bring us in your throne room of grace this morning, and pray that you pray to be here for us, be glorified, and give them that call that you have. I'm going to go to the next slide.
Thank you. I'm going to go to the next slide. Great time to work this together. We're so loud. It's good to
Did you push them out that way? And he said, you can see that door preaching there, but open it out there. They also were saying, they appreciate you, this Tori, who's joining our working team this morning. You're learning, you're doing great.
the only thing we talk about it enough. But before we jump into sanctification, before you can truly understand or appreciate what sanctification means, there's another word we need to look at. And it's justification. So that's where we're going to start this morning. If you turn to Romans chapter 3, I'm going to pick up with verse 21, and I'm going to read verses 21 to 24 together. The Apostle Paul is writing to various churches in and around Rome. He says here in Romans 3, but now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jews and Gentiles, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and that all are justified freely. God is grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Paul just said a lot. Matter of fact, if I really wanted to, we could spend months just in this one little passage. I don't want to do that. I'm going to share with you this morning four foundational truths that we just read here in this passage. And when I say foundational, I mean, if you get these four truths wrong, your eternal soul could be wrong. If you cannot agree to these four foundational truths, I do not believe heaven will be your home. That is so important for us to understand. There are things in Scripture that are essential doctrines of the faith, meaning we have to agree on these for salvation. And then there are things that we don't necessarily have to agree on every issue. I go further, which is not essential. It's still important, but they're not. In other words, we're going to get to heaven and we're going to find, I'll give you a quick example, water of Trinity. Some churches believe wholeheartedly that you can celebrate at the Lord's table every single Sunday morning. Other churches like us, we celebrate usually monthly the first Sunday of the month. I can promise you, when you get to heaven, there will be people in heaven celebrating once a month and celebrating every week. I promise you, we'll be there. That's a non-essential doctrine. It's important, but it's non-essential. What I'm about to share with you this morning is not that way. Things are essential. Truth number one. When Paul uses the word justify, or when you see him writing justification, this is a legal term. Here's what it means. You can't be wrong about justification. Justification means that a broken person is declared not guilty. And the simplest term I can give you, or definition, imagine it is a legal term. It's all given a courtroom term. Come before a judge, you know you're guilty, you did it, there's no way around it, you deserve punishment, and you stand before the judge, and the judge says, I declare you from this day forward not guilty. He drops the gavel. You leave there completely justified. That is the simplest definition I can give you, but it goes much, much deeper than that. That brings us to truth number two. You cannot be justified. You cannot be declared not guilty by law keeping. Now, when Paul wrote this letter, you find in Romans chapter 1 where he addresses this letter to several different churches. All of these churches were in or around the city of Rome. And we know, historically, we know that these churches were filled with Roman Christians, probably raised in pagan culture, but they also had a large Jewish population. Jews who were raised in Judaism, who heard the gospel, and now they're gathering together with these pagans who heard the gospel, and now they're all in one church. I've said it before. I don't know how anybody got to this church. I can just imagine going to a first century church where all the Jewish people are on one side, and all the pagans and heathens are on the other side, and somehow you have to preach to these people every week, every day. Oh, I don't know how to pull that off. But that's the kind of church called gratitude. So when he says here, I want you to imagine if there's a messenger of that church is standing in front of these churches in the world and they read this, and Paul says, you cannot be justified, you cannot be right before God by keeping the law. the Jewish side of the church would have been thinking, whoa, you tell me that the Ten Commandments doesn't make me right before God? And Paul would say, no, they don't. You can do every Sabbath, you can raise sacrifices to the altar, you can do all the ceremonial cleansing and washing, and you can trim your hair a certain way, you can dress a certain way, you can do all that stuff a certain way. That's still be lost for all of them. That's what he wants to know. You cannot be right before God by law. The pagans on the other side, they were probably thinking of all these weird customs and rules they had related to their pagan religion. And Paul speaks to them teaching, there's no box in the text. Okay, I did this. That's for you right before God. It's all for them. None of that can make you righteous. None of that can make you holy. None of that declares you right before God. That leads us to truth number three. The only way you can be justified before God is to faith in Jesus. Not faith in anything else, not faith in anyone else, only faith in God as you write before God. Only through that can you be justified. There's no other way around it. So, how do you say it? This is one of the things that makes Christianity so popular. There are a lot of people out there that are really ashamed that you practice a different religion than them. Hindus, most Hindus are real okay if you want to practice Christianity or Judaism or Roman Catholicism or any other thing. They're okay with that, where people get really fired up when you say that. Only through Christ can you have it. Boom! That's when they explode. You're so frustrated and closed off. No, really, you think you guys are the only ones that have the corner marker on the tree? That's the only answer you can show. Christianity is an exclusive religion. If that bothers you, you may not be part of it. And the Son is an exclusive. We absolutely believe there's no way the Father will be the Son. If you deny the Son, you deny the Father. There's no other way. Well, no, I think we can say because we say there's only one way to do it. It's in Jesus. Love you, your family. And what pays us is your family. It's God. Truth number four. Both Jew and Gentile, both sides of the church are sharing this message. Both Jew and Gentile are in the exact same boat. Both are sinners who have fallen short of God's grace. That's what Paul says. We have all sinned. We've all fallen short of God's glory. Jesus has sinners who have sinned. Grace makes the distinction, and God makes no distinction. Historically, there are distinctions. But when it comes to salvation, there is none. We're all fallen, we're all sinners, and all of us can only be justified, and Jews can only receive eternal life if they believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, they confess, they repent, and they acknowledge the Lordship of Christ. That's the only way Jews can be saved. Guess what? The only way Gentiles can be saved is the same way. There's no distinction of salvation. Paul says in Acts 3, the same is true for us. The moment you heard the gospel, the moment you believe it, the moment you place your faith in the holy sacrificial blood of Jesus, what happened to you? You were justified. You were declared completely righteous. Even more than that, I love it. You were covered with the righteousness. 2 Corinthians 5:21 is probably one of my favorite things that's been happening to many through that year. God made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we become the righteousness. So, in other words, we have this big trade off. Jesus said, give me all your sins, and he did. Jesus said, I'm going to give you all my righteousness. That is imputed to you the moment you believe. This is why I love this passage, and this is why it's up on our wall here. It says, it's too deep. By grace, we've been saved through faith. It's not through you. It's not through you. It is the gift of God. It's not a result of works, so that no one can boast about it. This is why we're not just asking to remember that we're not going to ask you to do things to be committed. We want you to be committed to justification. You know why? Because of what you're doing. If you've been truly born again, if you've been truly justified by grace and faith, and I'm saying on this comment, and some of you may have a problem with this, but I firmly believe that Paul does is looking at chapter 1, he says, I am sure of this, I'm confident of this. This is the end of his work for the reason of his spirit. He's here for the reason. He's able to work and see the work through him. Formal and local church membership. It's got to be reserved for those who are justified by grace through faith. Hopefully, you have a clear understanding of what justice is. And only then are you ready to move on. These two terms get misused a lot when misunderstood. What is sanctification? Well, let's let the Apostle Peter answer the turn of 2 Peter chapter 3 in your Bible. 2 Peter chapter 3. We'll pick up in verse 17 and read verse 17 and 18. Read now with your ID today, some weeks. If you're more than watching in the video, that's why. As I read in several translations, it seems like your ID is going to capture it more reasonably. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 17. We talk to Peter says, therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, be on your guard. So that you may not be carried away by the error of your lawless, the fall from your superior position. But grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and ever. Amen. I acknowledge that one Peter does not use the word sanctification. He uses a very clear sanctification is to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. If you want to be even simpler than that, sanctification is the ongoing growth in knowledge. That's right. That's right. As I grow in grace and as I grow in knowledge, it doesn't mean I just become smarter or more informed about who Jesus is. It means as I learn more and more about Jesus, I allow that to change and transform my life. When I see the way Jesus loves people, I start loving people like that. When I see what Jesus enabled the apostles to go out and preach, I preach that. I believe that. I hold that. The more I learn about Jesus, the more I want to be like him. That's what faith today is. It's growing to be more and more like Jesus every day. The other New Testament authors refer to sanctification a little differently. Sometimes they use the word holiness to refer to sanctification, like in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. The author of Hebrews says, strive to be with everyone, and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. And we need to hone in on that word strive. It means to work really hard. It means get down there, get your hands dirty, sweat a little bit, do it, and striving for something. It's not the runner running the race and you're trying to get to the end. It's striving to reach the finish line. That's the word the author of Hebrews is using. Work hard at two things. One, not be at peace with everyone. That's the whole thing. But two, it's a long, hard journey. If you think that just being the same, just being justified, you can grow like a plant just naturally does, blow up and blow in good fruit, it does not matter that way. I'm going to tell you, take some blood, sweat, and tears. It's not easy. That's why the author of Jesus is the best. He's got to work hard. But here's the good news. He's working with you to help you do that. I also want you to notice the author of Hebrews does not say strive to satisfy. Remember, in a lot of that's not good. It's not good. Here's the best way I can put these two together for you. By grace, you have received the free gift of salvation and made possible by faith in Jesus and died as you have been saved. By grace, you have been saved. the moment that happened, the moment you believe that, you were completely, fully justified to be made righteous, the righteousness is imputed to you. But the moment that happens, you start the journey. You turn the road. You have to go to start walking. Start living out what I've made you to be. What we're asking is to make the very minimum. So it's very important. It's very easy to do. Peter taught us that he's on one side of the other. What I mean by that is no people who emphasize justification at the expense of justification. Let me tell you what that looks like. These are the people who believe they can do it any way they want to make anything at any time at all the great and great. They just fly around and look at flying in the world, and then when you question about it, they say, oh, you're ready for that? 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 The other thing is the anger of the Christ. And all they were focused on was a week. How do you dress? Because you're ready. What are you going to turn to? How much do you give to the office? Not if you give words to the gentleman, how much do you give? How often do you say swear words? How often do you think ahead of your thoughts? Those are the people that just bombard you with all these external things because they think, well, God may have made you, I've got to keep myself out. We have a battlefield throughout. We need both justification and sanctification. And we have a clear understanding of that. I was just trying to justify my faith. How exactly do I hold this off? How do I pursue my sanctification? I only know for then I didn't know what this word was. He tells me, quickly, again, you know, they must keep talking about this, but I'm not, I'm going to admit it. When Jesus is praying for his disciples, John reported this prayer of Jesus right before he speaks. And Jesus in the garden was praying for his disciples in John chapter 17, and John actually was full of the time of death, and he was born from that prayer. And there's one little line in that prayer where Jesus was praying to the Father in John chapter 17, verse 17, and he said, Father, sanctify me in your truth. Your word is true. You cannot grow in your sanctification without knowing. For whatever reason, God chose to reveal His testimony, the Word, the written Word. And folks, I know some of you don't like to read. Some of you may, I don't think very well. It's hard for me to do that. You know, we live in a time when we're very blessed. There's audible books now. There's audible Bibles now. There's free apps out there that you can listen to around the room. There's a lot of different ways to take this in. You've got to take it in. You will not grow in Christ's likeness if you know more about Christ. And the only way you can do that is certainly under biblical preaching and teaching, and then going on and feeding yourself constantly in this way. Memorize it. Study it. You have other people who might understand it better than you. Tell your questions about it. Whatever you've got to do, you've got to get in there because this is how sanctification happens. You do not grow spiritually with this definition. It's not what they're bringing. They're not Christian friends. It's just what they're saying is real. This word is real. And if you're growing this word, God will be doing things like this to you as a Christian friend to help water you. We've also been asking you to do it. If you've never read the book of James, it's not as straightforward. Jesus is right in the teeth. He says in James chapter 1, verse 21, he says, believe with your, he's consistent, he's right, and he says, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness. So he sees this ministry, this implanted word, which is at his favorite place. One way to refer to the word of God, if you refer to God's word as a tree that finds good ground and good soil in your heart, and will wait for it to just bring it to you. Receive the word by that. Let it be reflected in your heart. But did you know that? He said there's something we can do in the court. Disregard it. Disregard it out, so you can get the good stuff in. I firmly believe with all my heart that one of the reasons Christians don't grow in the sanctification as they should is there's way too much worldly garbage that's coming out of this seat of the Word. I'm not expecting anything in the numbers of this church that I myself cannot do. So to cover the doctrine of justification and to cover the doctrine of sanctification, I want to quickly wrap up with this one other word I want to be aware of for you. In justification and sanctification, I want to talk to you for just a minute about glory. That these three things round out this golden trio. Paul wrote to the first Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians 5 and says, this is how the New American Standard Bible. He says, now may the God of truth himself sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit, soul, and body be preserved complete without blame at the coming of our Lord Jesus. I'm not sure how long I'll be here. I think I was ready to go to the revival and things like that. I think I remember that happening. I went through a lot of years after that, right? I was sad I was not sitting here. But somewhere after losing really feel like I'm coming to be in a relationship with God, I think it was an adult whether I had to go out of service. Either way, I believe right now, maybe not as long as I'm before this, I've probably been justified longer than I've been unjustified, right? I'm going to confess to you, I'm still trying. There is more going on in my family, and all of it as well. There are times I really wrestle with my friends. I'm going to say at least a couple times a week, I come before the Lord, and I say, oh, my goodness. To be so shameful for me to understand how I feel. How do I feel like that? How do I say that? How do I respond that way? How do I cut off the way I just did? There's coming a day where we, right now, our justification is positional, and Paul said there's coming a day we need to turn where it will be. But now he declares us righteous, and then he gives us the Spirit to try to live that out. That comes in anywhere, we'll do a duty exactly in the garden of heaven. So, what that should look like, I can imagine what heaven's going to do after I'm not even thinking to the influence of the church of the Lord. But I need you to do this this morning. And what you will need here today is understanding that your salvation a past, a present, and a future of the past, he is justified freely at the cross of Jesus Christ. In the present, the Spirit of God enables you to live out what he has already made you to do. And in the present, and the future, that's for you. That's for you. So there's a past, a present, and a future element for salvation, and for the last one. Father, thank you so much for the truth of Scripture and the Word. Lord, I thank you for loving us. And Lord, even though I realize that I'm sure there's many of the same over this morning, that I'm not with it. Lord, so far, Father, I'm still more of all of it. My flesh is sinning, my sinful desires are not the time to have them. I just believe it's not going to be my own family and theirs. And Lord, I thank you for the blood of Jesus. That not only has he walked in your presence, but he's made you true. Lord, you have clothed me. And the resurrection covered me. You have put like the cross of sin when you return home, the Father puts the best robe around you. They left us. We are prodigal to return home, and we have been clothed in the righteousness of Christ. And I pray, Lord, that you so clothed this morning. Every true believer here today, I pray that they know, even in their worst time, in their worst moment, we see them as you do it. Who they are to you. And I also pray, Lord, that that next one gives us all type of life that you have put into you. And God, to give us that to be continued to close and grateful around the God is going to close. Lord, convict us in those moments when we step outside the boundary lines of your will, and it's in our mind, in our actions, and words of faith, whatever it is, we thank you for the convicting power of the Spirit that drives us to confess it. And reminds us about praying and praying for the community. So pray for every justified sin here today to empower us to walk in the cross of truth to you. And Lord, I also want to pray for those that might be here this morning and maybe you're impressed upon their heart that they do not justify by grace to Jesus. Maybe they thought that they were for years and in truth they know they're not. Maybe they're hearing this gospel truth for the first time today. But Lord, I pray that you would do a miraculous work of transformation in their hearts, that you would pour out amazing grace to this person. That you hear it, that they receive it, that you believe it, and that they would be born of this into this world. And there's a vow of prayer, that's all I want to ask you to bless you. I do not believe I have been justified by grace and faith. I do not believe that heaven would be my eternal home if I left this life today. I don't think I'm ready. But that's you. All I want to do is pray with you. I just want to know who you are, so I can follow up with you later. Quickly, just put your hand up and grab that glass and I know who you're praying with. Anybody in here would say, we need to get this done. Anyway. Father, you are so good, and I thank you again for the good work that you're doing in this gathering, in this local church. And I pray that you continue to speak powerfully to our hearts, that you enable us to go out and live selfish, and upright lives in this present evil age. And Lord, I want to say that you're thanking you again this morning. What a blessing it is to all the people that are involved in so many ministries of this church. Thank you for our marriage community, the people who are holding ours, and getting prepared for this marriage retreat coming up. Thank you for those that are working our youth, our kids, our youth ministry, our women's ministry. God, there's so many things going on right now. And I just want to thank you for everybody that's doing every work in our family to bless them with God. Lord, I love this church. I thank you walking through every day, and I know you will. And thank you for the sins of this place, the powerful, everyone. Be glorified in all that we do. We ask you for Christ's name and all that's in your name. And God, let's go for one last day.